I particularly like this graphic. Has anybody ever felt like this? Hopefully you're not feeling like that today. But our goal in presentation is to show your system needs and expose the problem so you can gain community support. And visual representations are usually the best way to do that. First of these is tables and charts. Be able to graph what your system is doing pumpage-wise, and if you can show visually what would be reams and reams of paper and tables, you're going to get your point across much quicker. But there is a ton of different ways that you can do this. Being an engineer, we love Excel, and it's a great tool to input the information in. And then prepare tables and charts to show that to your customers and to your board. The other forms of presentation are graphing, either be it by computer system. We love, as engineers, the new SCADA or supervisor control and data acquisition systems that most utilities are installing, because they give wonderful visual representations of, be it any type of operating item in your system. Tank levels. You can now chart those on a SCADA system and show changes, multiple tanks on one chart, and those are great tools to take to your board and show them where you can't keep a tank filled. There's still the old paper chart recorders and the circular chart recorders. If you've got a tank chart like this that's showing severe overuse of that tank. Another way of documenting and presenting your information is flow diagrams. There's tons of different ways you can document your system and visually represent to your board and to the customers how the water gets out of the ground and to their home, and from their home back to the wastewater treatment plant, back into the stream. There's flow diagrams, IO diagrams, in and out diagrams. So you can do these yourself, or there's many communities that like to work with a engineer and say, this is what I want, draw it up. You can go simple, you can go complex. You just have to make a decision on what you would like to represent and portray to your board and to your customers. Take pictures. Pictures are a wonderful thing for documenting and then presenting to your board and to your customers the problems that you're having out in the system. Be it construction, where you've had to go back in and repair lines, show them what you're doing right, where you've got a good portion of your system that you're maintaining. Show them parts of your treatment system if they're corroding and falling apart. And show them what you've done once you've done a project to show how good it can look and how it is at the end of a project. One of the great things and newer tools out there, I know everybody's heard of it, is Global Information System. And we're seeing more and more, and I think everybody's getting into it because it's a wonderful tool for documenting and keeping information. But it takes hardware, software, the people that know how to use it, the application program that actually runs, and then you've got to take the time to input all the data into the GIS system. There's a bunch of information right here. But the two main points on a GIS system, it's a great tool for organizing information geographically, and it serves as a great process for serving the needs of your citizens for your community. One of the reasons we love it is you can attach visual information to a specific geographic point. So all those pictures that you took of a construction project, you can actually link to your GIS system and have them come up nice and easy. And then you have to go and make a presentation. You can actually just pull up your GIS system and say, here's the problems we've had. Here's a visual. You can see it yourself. You don't even have to go out there. Steve's going to talk a little bit about system modeling.
How many of you actually have a hydraulic model of your water system? A couple of people? Okay. Well, as you know, these things can spit out reams and reams of data. But they're very, very useful for a lot of things. What's that?
Come over here.
Okay.
This is one we actually did for the city of Plymouth, Indiana, which has two elevated storage tanks, two water treatment plants. But we've done a hydraulic model of their entire system. One of the things they like to do, they've actually asked me to run this model and print them out maps showing the directional flow in the system, both with the plants running and with the plants off, whether the system is being fed by elevated storage or if it's being fed by a combination of elevated storage and pumping equipment. So I don't know why they do that. I think they're trying to get an idea for the direction of flow and using that information when they set up. They're also trying to set up a unidirectional flushing program. And these things can be useful for that as well, giving an idea of how you can raise your velocity in the system by operating various valves and that sort of thing. Go ahead and flip to the next slide. This is just a very, very small portion which I cut out and blew up, just to show you the type of information we normally try to record. These things will give you reports on any aspect of the system, junction nodes. Junction node is basically a location in the system where two pipes either intersect or where a pipe ends. You also have a node for a tank, for a pump, for things, any place where you want to document a large demand user, anything like that, you want to put that information in the system. Obviously, these require a heck of a lot of data to get them running and working reliably and properly. You've got to know elevation information at all those nodes. You've got to know what the system demand is at that location and input data that is sound and reliable. The hydraulic grade line, it's going to give you based upon what's actually happening in the system, tank levels, pumps running, that sort of thing. And then the last column is what the operator is most interested in. And we run these for lots of different demand conditions, an average day demand, maximum day demand, a peak hour demand, and they can see what's actually happening in their system under those various demand conditions. And it will help them identify particularly bottlenecks in the system, an area that maybe is operating at very poor pressure during the peak demand when it's okay during an average day demand. That would indicate that there's a bottleneck in the system somewhere. Next. They're also very useful for showing what your fire flow potentials are at various locations. We do this a lot to show, well, here's where your fire flow is now. If you have a situation where there's a lot of, institutional water, schools, municipal buildings, anything that would typically require a large fire flow demand, just give them an idea of what they've got. We can also modify the model quickly and show, well, with this improvement or with this loop, this is where we can get it up to. So it's done a lot for fire flow modeling and also to show where the bottlenecks are in the system.
It's a great tool for using when you have a new industry that wants to come into town and say that it's a big box building and they need 3,000 gallon a minute. You can tell your engineer or whoever you have running your model, okay, we need 3,000 gallon a minute at this location, what can we do? And the engineer says, well, you've only got 1,500 gallon a minute there now. Well, you're going to have to add these two lines to feed this area, and then you can get it up to 3,000 gallon a minute. for that. Kyle's going to cover cups.
So no one here has used cups before, is that right? And we talked about earlier, I know Steve and Mike talked earlier about documenting your system. And basically what CUPS is a software that was created by the EPA that's designed exactly to do that, to help you document what you have out in your system. And this is basically what they consider as asset management. That's what CUPS is designed for. And the only reason why I have this up there is I like the fact that it includes, that it contains desired level of customer service. Sometimes that gets lost, you know, when utilities are operating on a daily basis, but that what they're actually providing is customer driven. And the second part that I like about the definition is it says at the best appropriate cost. So it doesn't mean you bend over backwards, put your utility in the red to give, you know, every single thing that every single customer wants. So you have to do a balancing act between, you know, what you have, what the capabilities of your system are, and the demands of the customer. The three main areas of the utility that the program focuses on is current assets. There's a database section in there where you can input information about all the assets that you have in your utility, such as like fire hydrants, elevated storage tanks, anything to that nature. The second part that it focuses on is tasks. The program has a task management section of it, so you can follow the tasks and keep on what needs to be done on a daily basis. And the third focus of the program is actually financial records. So you can actually put in your budgeted estimates, your actual estimates, you know, your net revenues, and your operating costs as well into this program. And I'll talk about that a little more in detail later. And basically, these are some of the generic benefits for using the software. If you deem to use it, you can make decisions that are fact-driven because you know what's out in the field. You know what type of equipment you have, so you don't have to go back and reinvent the wheel. Increased focus, obviously, you know what's out there. Time savings, you know, again, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. Service, you know, that goes hand in hand. Stay on top of the tasks that you're performing, and it will increase the service capabilities of your utility. Funding, keeping track of, you know, this will, it comes with a program where you can actually use it to determine, you know, how much you should be actually charging your customers. It's got tools in there where you can kind of see how your, you know, financial records are doing. And also, it's got a presentation capability to this software. So all the information you put in about your assets, tasks, and financial records, this program will actually generate a pre-populated report that you can use to show individuals or decision makers to say, you know, look, this is the current status of our system, and this is what needs to be done. A little short history about it. The program was created in 2008, late 2008, by the EPA. Since then, there's been several different revisions of the program and software. The most current version right now is version 1.3.5, so they are updating it every so often. And basically, it was put together by a work group, all got together, consisting of these organizations, and so it got input from all these different groups. And what they came up with was CUPS. The exciting thing about software, I guess, what I consider exciting, is that the program is free. So if you want to get a copy of version of this program, all you have to do is Google EPA CUPS, and you should be able to take it right to the first hit, and you should be able to download it straight from there. If you don't like to download for whatever reason, there's actually a 1-800 number as well, so you can actually call that and get a hard copy CD mailed to your address. All you need is a Windows 95 operating basis or a system or later. It will work on Windows Vista and Windows 7. There's a little tweaking you have to do, but it can work on your system. When you do download it, you do have to register the software. But what I like to point out is that this software is actually non-internet based. You, You do not need an internet connection to use the software. So you don't have to worry about the big brother looking in on you and trying to steal information as you're using the program. So it's basically standalone. You can use it however you want. This is the initial startup screen. The reason why I include it is it's basically a database-driven software, and you can put as many databases as you want. So if you want to split up your utility system into zones, you can create different databases from each zone. And also, it comes with an example CUPS already with the software when you download it. So it actually comes with a starting point. If you want to look at, you know, if you ever come lost and say, you know, well, what can I really do with this database? You can always go into the example CUPS and see how they set it up, and you can go from there. I know some people are here are in charge of wastewater systems. This does work for wastewater and drinking water facilities. So it can go either way. You just have to select what type of system you have. This is basically just showing the initial startup screen. This is information you input. This is where you can determine if it's a drinking water or a wastewater facility. And a lot of this information is pretty generic, but what they do is they use that information to generate it in the report. So all that information, they use it when you print out the reports that I'll talk about here in a second. It's also, you can create your own username and passcode. So if you want to lock people out of your database, you can use it. Set up some really complicated password if you want. If you ever lose it, it does actually save it in a notepad file under your program directory, so you can always go back and try to find it. So if you lose your passcode, you're not completely sunk. And here is the O&M section when you first start up your program and create your database. What happens is this software becomes pre-populated with a list of number of tasks that they believe a small drinking water facility or wastewater facility typically performs. So you can either use these tasks or not. It's ultimately up to you. What it does is it separates it between daily, monthly, and annual tasks and weekly tasks. If you disagree with how they have it set it up, you can change how often these tasks occur. So you can change a monthly task to a daily task. You can say, I want to perform this task on the first Monday of every month, or you can say every Tuesday for whatever reason. You can set up your tasks however you want. So it's a task-oriented program as well. And this section, when you first started up, here's where you add your fellow water team members, whoever's working with you in the utility. The advantages of doing that is you can actually assign individual tasks to these individuals, so you can keep track to see if they're actually performing them or not. And also, if you want to give them access to the database as well, you can set them up as their own username and passcode. This is the initial startup screen. When you first access the program, first what pops up, you can either have it pop up or not. It's all ultimately up to you. But that's basically a task notification window right there in the center. So that's telling you what needs to be done today. And it also lists any past due tasks, any tasks that weren't done previously. So you get rid of that window. You can see in the upper left, you can access all the different aspects of the program using the tabs or the icons in the center. You can see this is the My Home page. You have the My Inventory. This is where you put all your asset information. You have the My O&M. This is where all that task information that I talked about earlier goes. The My Financial section, that's where you put all your finances and all that information there. And the last two tabs, the My Checkup and the My Cups Plan, that's where the software generates pre-populated reports. And then here you can see there's a little calendar on the upper right, a little shortcut calendar. The red indicates any past due tasks that weren't done. The blue is the day's date. And then the yellow are any upcoming tasks. So this is what the O&M section looks like. You can add your own single event tasks if you so desire. So you're not limited to what the EPA has created in the task setup. So you can create one single event task, or you know, you can do a repeating task, and you can customize it to whatever task you feel is required. And red, of course, indicates any past due task, and yellow is any upcoming task. If you ever get tired of looking at a computer screen, I know I do, but you can actually print these task order sheets right out of the program. And this is a blank sheet. This is what it typically looks like. You can input all this information that you want. You can add notes if you want to add additional information about a certain task. You can put in cost. How much is this task going to cost? You can also put in, you can assign who's supposed to do the task. And it will also keep track of the task that's been performed. And on the bottom, you can actually put in information about any spare parts that are required to do the task. Such as, parts numbers, who provided the information. So let's say you're trying to replace a water meter. You can say, we got this water meter from XYZ. And in order to perform this task, I need to contact XYZ. Oh, and you can print these tasks over a data range as well. So let's say you're on vacation for a week, if you're lucky enough to go on a vacation. And you can actually say, you can print off a date range. So let's say you're gone from October 1st to October 7th, and you want to know what happened in your system. So you can print off this data range, and you can go through all these individual tasks and see, well, this task was performed, this one was not, performed, and then you can follow up and say, why wasn't, XYZ, why didn't you get that done while I was gone? So you can use that as documentation on your system and to present it to others saying, this is what we're doing. It's basically just showing that. Now I'm going to go into the My Inventory section of the program. And here's where you put all the information that you have that's out in the system. Now, you don't have to put everything that you have in your system. You can start off small. You can start off with what you have along Main Street or, however you want to set it up. And then when you feel more comfortable with the system, you can expand it from there. As you can see, you can actually create a schematic of all of your assets, and you can link the assets together using those arrows. For example, on this one, it shows, well property, well house, well number one, and pump. Those basically are probably a single site. It's got the chain link fence, so that's why the security icon is linked to all those items. If you don't want to create a schematic, you don't have to. You can always just create a list, which is shown on the lower right. And you can put as many assets on there as you can think of. There's no size limitation in the software. And if you really want to get high tech, you can actually, if you have the coordinate locations for all these assets, you can actually XREF these out into Google Earth if you really wanted to. So you can zoom in on Google Earth and it'll show your well property where it's supposed to be. And here, just showing, basically you can click and drag your icons, it'll keep the links, and also you can, there's a fire hydrant asset being added to the right. And this is the list of all the icons that are available in the software. It's a little limited. So if you have an asset that doesn't quite fall under any of these icons, you can use the other icon, which is the big circle, and you can name it accordingly. And you can see it does have drinking water and wastewater icons as well. And very similar to the My Task section, you can actually print off page reports for all your assets as well. You can add information such as how much did this asset cost. You can put in information about the life expectancy of your asset. Is it going to last 10 years? When it nears the end of that 10 years, it will actually create a task saying, on that date, I need to replace this pump or whatever. So it actually, this asset section is linked to the task section as well. And you can put in information, based on the information you input, you can determine, the consequence of failure of your asset. If this asset goes out, will I be able to make my system needs? And then, you know, basically it does calculate also the probability of failure. How likely is the asset going to fail in the future? And that's based on the redundancy of the asset and the life expectancy of it. And you can also put information about where, you know, about the supplier, number, model number information and things like that. And what it can do, based on the probability of failure of an asset or the consequence of the failure of an asset, it'll rank them based on if the assets were either a high risk, medium risk, or low risk. And it doesn't mean you have to follow this, you know, say, well, this asset, you know, once it goes over that little line, it's going to be a high risk asset. I mean, you can use your judgment, obviously. But so basically, a scale goes from 0 to 10, and 0 to 10. And basically, as you, on the x-axis, you go to the right, it's the probability of failure increases, so the higher risk the asset is. And as you go up, the consequence of failure, the higher the risk is as well. So it's just basically a tool that you could potentially use to determine what assets are more important or need more attention than others. So that was the my inventory section. This next section is basically the financial section. This is where you can put all your net expenses, revenues. You can put in budgeted amounts as well, budgeted expenses, budgeted revenues, information such as that. And basically what you can do is you can create graphs. So you can show this to, you know, people that are trying to make decisions in your system. You can say, look, this is how far we're running into the to the black or into the red. Or, you know, just to show people, well, we need to do something. We need to use our raise our utility rates because we can't maintain our current practices. So it's another tool that you can use to have a visual aid to show others. And same with everything else, you can print off little financial report sheets as well. All right. So this is the My Checkup section and My Cups Plan section, what I'll talk about next. This is basically where you can get XREF, export all the information you just inputted concerning your assets, your tasks, and basically your finances. This is the asset report. You see, it comes up with the, you know, expressed right out into a Word document. You can edit the document however you like. You don't have to stick with this. If you want to add something, subtract something, you can go right ahead and just get into the Word document. And here's like a little introduction section. You can see there's some blanks where you can fill it in however you feel is appropriate. So it can save you time, so you don't have to create your own report all the way from scratch every time you have to do a, you know, an asset checkup report. And it also prints off the schematic of your system as well. So if you can, you can use that as a visual aid when discussing with individuals that, you know, you're trying to teach them something about what's going on in your system. I mean, it's not the highest, the greatest graphic, but, you know, it's a start. You can use it. And then, yeah, here's that asset risk table that's included in the report. And also creates a table about all your assets that you have available. You know, it ranks them, you know, whether, you know, the status is it, status of the asset, is it poor, high, or is it good quality? Also, if it's, you know, a high risk or low risk. And then you can also have additional asset details, all the information you inputted on the about the asset as well, in the back of the report. The financial side of the report, this is where you can actually do projections, 10-year projections out about what you think is going to happen in your system. So you can put in growth rates for every year, or a, you know, standard growth rate, and you can also put inflation rates as well. And when you put all that information, you'll get your financial report. Here you can see the graph we talked about earlier, and this is showing the actual revenue as compared to the, you know, actual revenue and expenses to actually budgeted revenue and expenses. And it's got other additional graphs as well. Here's your financial table that you can use, and it actually has some metrics as well that it creates. It creates some ratios and explains what those ratios are in the report. And it actually comes up with what happens when you have an asset that's high at risk or it needs to be replaced soon, what it'll do is it'll calculate how much you need to start saving now to replace that asset 10 years down the road. And so here's just basically showing some of the projects that are, you know, up and coming. And then here's additional, all the financial information you can input. And then the last section of the report is basically the My Cups plan. This is what I consider the year-end, or like an annual type report. It contains all the information I've talked about before, such as, you know, the inventory of the tasks and my finances, all that information. But what else you can add in there is an executive summary. You can put in like mission statements for your utility, you know, whether that be a deep, you can also put in goals, you know, whether that be like decreased response time to customer complaints. You can put in information about, you know, who's on your utility team, and basically all the information in those other reports you can put in there, plus little other tweaks. Basically what I've got about the checkup program for small systems.
When we get done with the overall presentation today, we have the actual program on another computer, so if anybody wants to come up, we'd be happy to pull the actual program up and demonstrate it. We just don't have time right now that the presentation stays, so Matt will take care of it at the end if you want to see it. For that, Mike's going to talk a little bit about preliminary engineering report.
Thanks, Pat. Hopefully everybody's still awake. Anybody need any replenishment? Anybody? No?
Okay. Kind of what we've talked about up to this point are ways, concise to the point, of things to present to your council or your board of public works, whichever you typically deal with. And at most councils, I'm sure they're wanting to be concise and to the point. How much is this going to cost will be the first thing they ask. The second thing is, prove it. Why do we need it? That goes back to all the documentation. Now, we get into some of the bigger stuff, and when you sit there and say, well, this is going to cost you probably in the range of several hundred thousand to possibly several million, after your council gets done laughing at you and wiping the tears out of their eyes, this is where we step in with the preliminary engineering reports, where we help with getting different types of funding out there for you. And that's what these are typically done. Has anybody had PERs, as they're normally called? Has anybody had those completed for their utility? Okay, a few of you have. These are typically required to get funding, such as State Revolving Fund or SRF, rural development, things like that. Provides a snapshot of the system, and we kind of tie back in with the documentation. If you have a lot of your stuff documented, it allows your engineer to complete this report quickly and efficiently. And then what it will do then, the results of the report will be typically like a 1 to 3 year time frame, short-term solution improvement. These are different from the master plan, which will be discussed next. And most of your SRF and rural development funds, they're low interest rate funds, and they're typically dependent upon the community income survey. Your PERs, they will, as I said, discuss the system, provide a snapshot of the needs of the system. It will provide a solution to system improvements, and it provides a discussion and a description of each of the alternates to provide that solution. And then we discuss, provide advantages and disadvantages of each of those alternates. One of the biggest discussions that's involved in the PER is going to be the environmental. This area has to be completed, or I should say it's one of the biggest stumbling blocks for a PER. You need to coordinate with your state agencies and a lot of times federal agencies, depending on what you possibly could be impacting with your project. It's strongly encouraged to complete this part ahead of time, because that will be the lengthiest part of the process to getting the funding, and also gives a possible heads up to problems with each of your alternates that you're thinking about,
and could lead to the best solution.
Also included with the PER, like I said, with especially with environment requirements, can require studies to be submitted. Wetlands delineation would be a possible study that needs to be done ahead of time. Requires specific language within the report, and then has to be submitted to several different agencies, and then the report must provide minimum environmental impact. I'm going to show you just kind of an example, the table of contents of what's involved in the report. Each report is unique. Some are shorter, some are longer. Like I said, it depends on the complexity of the project that's being done. And also there are specific guidelines through the state and federal for each of your reports. Each report also has to include a no action alternative. Basically what this means is if nothing is done to the system, what impact will that have on the system and to its customers? Then you need to, as we said before, discuss the different alternates, and then you got to budget your different alternates, and then provide a rate impact of what those projects are going to cause to your customers. Here's just a quick example of a budget for a project that was proposed. And then here's a preliminary rate derivation that can be completed in the report. Engineers can provide this, but typically it's strongly recommended that you bring in rate consultants so they can do a thorough evaluation of the community, of the utility's assets, the rate structure, and then they can determine on the selected alternate what that impact's going to have on the rates. With that, back to Pat.
As Mike said, the PER is generally looking at items that you need to take care of in the next 1 to 3 years. If you want to go beyond that, then we go into what we call the master plan. And those are generally plans that we put together to look anywhere from 10 to 20 years out for the community, so you can be planning ahead. And it gives you a document that you can use and go back to the board for 5 to 10 years and say, this was the plan that was set up so many years ago, we've accomplished so many of these items, but this is where we stand currently. We're a year behind, so we need to get going again and keep moving and staying up on what needs to be done to keep our system current. And these are just some examples of some of the reports that we have done. Geneva, we did a project back in 1999, so this year, we're getting ready to start and update their water master plan 12 years later. So generally, it's a document you'll have and use for about 5 to 10 years, and then you're going to need to look at updating it once again. Lowell, another example, we did our project master plan in 2000. We're getting ready to do another update for them. But basically, a master plan includes an introduction of what is going to be discussed, gives general characteristics of the community, and then it gives a detailed overview of the entire system, be it waterworks or sewer facilities. This is geared towards the water side. Then we also look at what the land use is in the area, what growth is anticipated to occur, and what's the associated water requirements for that growth. And then we evaluate what is going to have to be done with the waterworks facilities to meet that growth over that time period and come up with a final recommendations and an improvements plan to deal with that over the next 5 to 20 years. That's the master plan side of things. That's usually just one utility. Then a lot of utilities and government agencies are looking at not only just one utility at a time, but they're looking at multiple utilities, water, wastewater, street, storm, and anything other utility that they have to manage. So when you get to that level, usually you're talking about what's called a capital improvements plan, where you take and combine all that into one large plan and look at it for, be it 5 to 10 years, so that you're not hitting up the community with $10 million in water work and $20 million in sewer work in the same year. You can try to mesh the plans together and even the burden over a more average cost over time. And the one nice thing about that is you can have maps that show what's anticipated for year one, year two, through however many years you want, color code them, and then you can have a corresponding sewer map, street map, whatever other that you want to have, because ultimately you've got to come up with your budgets to provide that clean drinking water and any other service that you provide. But this gives you a tool to do long-term planning over multiple utilities. With the plans, usually you then are looking at what are your funding options? How can I come up with the money to pay for these things? And as a part of the discussion in these plans, especially master plans and PERs, as Mike said, you do a review of the funding options, because you've got to deal with these water quality issues that you have out in the system. And first thing everybody says, can I get anything from the Fed to help me pay for my project? Well, everybody was big on the stimulus for a while, and those funds are now expended, so we're back to what we had before, which is basically the common funding sources, be it the Indiana Finance Authority that administers the State Revolving Fund. Like I said, the stimulus monies, as far as we are aware, are gone. There's been talk about a third round, but the way the Congress has been, I'm not anticipating or planning on any money out of them. One of the other programs out there is the Community Block Development Grant program out of the Office of Community and Rural Affairs, but that's only available to small communities that can prove that they're 51% low to mod. But it is one of the programs, if you have that capability, that needs to be looked at. Another one out there is USDA Rural Development, the old Farmers Home Administration. We always look at that. As long as they're a community under 10,000, you can only use that funding source if you're a population of under 10,000. One of the newer forms of funding projects out there is the County Economic Development Income Tax. Everybody calls it CEDIT, or there's another one called COIT, County Option Income Tax. If the county has enacted it, the county council or county commissioners usually have control over it, and it's set up to help fund economic development. So if you can prove that your project has some economic benefit, some communities have been going and trying to get that source of funds also. In doing your presentation, you also need to be talking to your board about how long is this project going to take. Depending upon your funding sources, it could easily be 2 to 3 years on a very fast track project. We've had projects, because of changing funding sources, that have gone up to 10 years. So you need to develop a schedule. You can keep it simple, or you can go very complicated with different bar charts. We recommend either a simple line chart like that, or a table just listing anticipated dates. It keeps it simple for your boards and your customers to understand, but it gives a definite timeline that they can follow to make sure the project continues on. That's presentation.